For our next presentation, we will have Johan Krebers review the OFP strategy and what is going to be our high-level direction, along with the links to other systems and entities, and also provide a high-level main roadmap and the steps to that. And for those of you who are just joining us or were not on earlier, Johan Krebers is one of the co-chairs of the OFP. He is also the IT CTO for Shell and is accountable for defining and driving the future of IT strategy for Shell. In addition, he maintains an active link with external parties and, in particular, startups. And Johan is based in Rijswijk in the Netherlands. So, Johan, if you would like to continue.
Okay, good afternoon, good morning, good evening. Yes, Johan Krebers out of Rijs, out of The Hague, close to Rijswijk. Let's talk about the strategy and a little bit also about the thinking behind it, where we're coming from, where we're heading for. This is the normal artist's depiction we show when we talk about open footprint. And I won't go about the artist, we'll talk a little bit about the thinking behind it. First, you see that gray space. And the gray space is really where the applications are. And the open footprint does not include the applications itself. It's important that our focus is really the data part, how to load the data, how to protect the data, how to access the data. But really, if people, where people really can differentiate and shine is, of course, in the applications part. So we really expect companies to come out there, start developing applications on top of the open footprint APIs. That whole ecosystem is very important for the future of open footprint, because that whole ecosystem will also enrich the platform over time, will also give new facilities to the platform over time. So the gray part, although we don't talk about that much because it's a little bit outside the scope of open footprint, it is a very important element of open footprint. And we try to stimulate it as much as possible, that people start developing applications out there, small company, large companies, etc. And because the APIs and of course the data below the API is all managed by the Open Footprint Forum, so that's kept independent of any provider out there. The other point made a little bit by Sammy about an hour ago is around, okay, we have here Open Footprint, and you saw the slide from Gomar a couple of hours ago, where he showed this sitting around the world. It's also very well possible. We're also very keen to move to what I always call the Open Footprint Insight story. And Sammy was hinting at that. But what we mean by that is really that companies can be any company out there. I won't mention names out here. Can say, hey, we're taking on the Open Footprint standards, the data definitions, the APIs, and embedded in our own platform under our own name. Yeah, but so under the cover, you have Open Footprint with the standards and the way the data is stored in the standard way, the data is accessed in the standard way. But on the outside, it might have a very different name on the box. So that we call the Open Footprint Insight. We're also keen for that whole way of work, because we also see also what start happening, that this type of data, the open footprint type of data, so the GHG data or the ESG data, more and more becomes part of your normal data platform. So today in this picture, you see it very much as a separate environment, but you can expect, really, you can expect that over time it becomes more and more part of your standard data platform, where you store your business data. You also expect it to store your GHG data. You also expect to store your ESG data. So that's really, you can expect that we see that happening over time, and we also will be ready for that. Therefore, we have to be ready for that, what I call open footprint inside story. I won't talk about the blue part, because the blue part has already been explained by Surab, the whole architecture part, but I want to make a little bit where we're coming from. This there's a little bit of history. If you're also a member of the OSDU forum and the open group, and Heidi was at the introduction was talking about also OSDU forum, then you see a picture not dissimilar. And under the cover, we've borrowed a lot of what we call open source facilities from OSDU, and how we use that in the open footprint. That gives us more speed, it gives us more flexibility to really get something out quite quickly. That doesn't mean that OSDU and open footprint therefore is geared towards one industry, because it's not. As explained by Gomar, the whole underpinning of open footprint is that it's industry neutral. It can work in any type of industry. It's not expected to work in a certain type of industry at all. So let's now go further to a little bit what our overall target is. Some of you have seen. So we're covering two things. We're covering, of course, at the moment, our first focus is the whole story of WWF DHG, so scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. And you've heard about from a number of players already what's meant by that. But we're also looking at the non-GHG scope, so like landfill, water, pollution, etc. That's not our first priority. Our first priority is really address in open footprint the GHG scope. Our second priority is also addressing the non-GHG scope. So we want to bring those two worlds together into a single open footprint data platform. So both the GHG world and the non-GHG world. So it's important to keep in the back of your mind. At the moment, our focus is, as I mentioned, to the GHG scope. And we talk about the open footprint inside scenarios. And you also heard about Sumuli about reporting. One of our objectives really very much so that open footprint becomes really the reporting source of information for the reporting status out there, for SASB, for WF, for other ones, for WCSD. And you heard from Anna about WCSD, and we're going to talk later on how the two fit together and where they come together. But we really want to really see, hey, how can we make life of SASB easier? How can we make sure that we get them seamless access to our open footprint environment? So how can we make sure that the open footprint APIs and the SASB reporting input, for instance, are well aligned? Yeah, so these are things we also are taking into account to really make that world a more seamless world. It's not in place today. Sumuli and his team start discussing next week on Monday, June 28th, the first meeting with SASB. Okay, how do we bring these two worlds together? And the last point is very important, and somebody made it earlier today. Anna made a point. We talk about carbon footprint. We talk about this whole world of GHG, etc. Let's be also honest with each other. It's still a very immature world. When we started in August last year, and we asked all our members, how are you doing your reporting on carbon footprint at the company level? All of them was purely done based on calculations. None of them was measurement. And the calculation was a spreadsheet at the enterprise level. It was anything under the sun you could think about. Yeah? That's where we are today. So when we talk about things like open footprint, we have to ensure that it supports that world. And therefore, you also saw it from Surab, we are entertaining a user interface for people who still do the calculations and that they can easily access the data into an open footprint environment. Yeah. So we have to entertain the world of people doing measurement, and we have to be ready for a world where people say, so people do calculations, and we have to be ready for the world where people do measurements. And I'll come back to that measurement story in a moment. Both, and of course, there will be a trend to go from calculations to measurements, and the measurements also will change over time. But we should not forget that also with MVP1, we have to support people who just do calculations, and it will for some years to come. They won't disappear tomorrow. And that's part of our design. And when we thought about open footprint, we made it very clear. If you look at MP1 and you see the demo tomorrow afternoon by the team, you also see it very clear that we have clear support there for that whole story of calculations. And the last point, and we do the market, flexible the future. Who knows what will be there in 2 years from now? This whole world is exploding. It's all over the place. Standards are coming on a day-to-day basis. So we have to be very, very flexible in our thinking, in our design, in the world. When you listen to Gomar, we have our main concern is the flexibility of the data platform, the data model out there, because we do not know what's going to hit us tomorrow, or the day after, or the day after, and we still need to be ready for that. So that last bullet point, the immaturity of the market we just spoke about, and secondly, the whole area of, okay, but how do we flexible for the future? Both we need to cover, and both we need to take into account. We talk about the strategy from day one. We thought about it. That's why the choice of the data platform was not something we did on a Friday afternoon at 5 o'clock. Say, oh, let's go for a data platform. We need a database. Let's put a database in there, and we're done. No, because flexibility is important. So it gives a little bit of the context where we're coming from, and you can bet your money that we still have some things wrong. So I'm fully aware of that, but we go for it. We take our chances. We take our decisions. We make very clear what decisions are. We might have to change them over time. I don't need to explain to anybody of you what scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3 is all about. From a strategy point of view, our first focus was to get scope 1 and scope 2 on the move. So MVP 1, a minimum viable product 1, which is out there, the focus of that was, okay, how do we cover scope 1? How do we scope 2? Scope 3 was not part of that. That's really what we did, but really say, hey, okay, because that is really the basic, scope 1 and scope 2. Then with MP2, and you're going to hear about it tomorrow, what we do in that space, but MP2, it's really what we add to scope 1 and scope 2, the calculations, and I'll come back to that in a moment, plus we added scope 3 to that space. And of course, scope 3 is a very interesting one, because if you talk about scope 3, you talk about many things you need to cater for. You need to cater for loading data from your scope 3 counterparts. There's a whole raft of systems you need to have around it to make scope 3 viable as part of your open footprint data platform. But that's where, and of course, if you, I come back to do what we do beyond that in a moment. I will. This a lot of that has been covered by Surab, but a couple of things important. First, the underpinning of the open platform data platform is open source, and also standards like for user authentication is open and deconnect standard. Every enterprise using, every company is using, it's a standard way of doing things. So we want to make sure that the threshold for getting open footprint to be used in your environment, small or large, and we talked about small environments a moment ago, is very low. We have to make sure that inside the data platform, we can support any type of metadata out there. Because metadata, if you heard before, is the crux of the whole data story. It's the crux about the lineage of data. How do you maintain the link between your raw data and your calculated data? It's all about metadata. Metadata maintains that link for you. So that metadata support in the platform is important. I won't talk about reporting because you heard an excellent story from Somali about reporting a moment ago. So we talked about OpenID Connect. You've heard also talking about auditing and talking about accounting. We've kicked off a project now also to really support how we link what we do to the whole world of accounting, and how we link this to the whole world of audit trails and logging. These are important components because the accounting piece is very important for us to have it embedded as part of the platform. So that's what we just kicked off as part of our MP2 and beyond MP2 activities. So it's all about that. It's the whole what we're doing is very incremental. We really want to make sure we get something out, and then we build on top of that. We know where we want to head for. We're not going to do it in one go because we will never get there. So it's really incremental. Get it out and get feedback. Incremental, get out and get feedback, and start implementing and improving one after the other. And some of the other points in the slide have already been explained, so I won't talk about it. Yeah, it's let's also talk about another element of the whole open footprint. We want to have open footprint out over time on multiple platforms. So we have it running on, as somebody mentioned before, we'll have it running on IBM Cloud, or Microsoft Cloud, on Amazon Cloud, or Google Cloud, and other environments. I just mentioned these as examples. They will be running open footprint. We have to make sure that these versions of open footprint are 100% aligned. So that we call it all, they need to all be part of what we call the common code base, the common code between each of the platforms. Why is that important? That's important for anybody who develops an application for the Open Footprint platform. As I mentioned before, if you open and if you develop an application in the gray part, you want to make sure that that application works on any of the Open Footprint implementations. As an application developer, you don't want to worry about, oh, this is an Open Footprint implementation on IBM. Oh, this is an Open Footprint implementation on Microsoft. Oh, this is an Open Footprint implementation on something else. You do not care. You have developed an application against the Open Footprint APIs. Your application can be running on a PC. Your application can be running on an on-premise system. I don't really care. And you should be able to access to make use on chains of the application on any of the Open Footprint implementations. So it's important for us, and a part of the whole strategy, to keep the Open Footprint implementation across the underlying platforms 100% the same, aligned and the same. So that's all part of the whole release strategy. So it's important that when you talk about Open Footprint, you don't just talk about, I have Open Footprint on IBM or Open Footprint something else. No, we always talk about we have Open Footprint in any platform, and we have to make sure that Open Footprint is aligned on any of these platforms from an application point of view. Because in the end of the day, why we also do Open Footprint, to give access to rich and innovative applications who can do very intelligent things with the data in the Open Footprint environment. And of course, but also it is the second bullet point over here is a little bit about, okay, what about data? As I mentioned in the beginning, we have to make sure we can cater for people who do calculations of data, yeah, just calculate the data. So that's the one end of the spectrum. We also have people over time. If you think about scope three, we're collecting data from various supply chain companies. It, of course, not too far in the future, that data will be collected via a sensor in the supply chain. That data will be connected, will be sent via IoT directly to your Open Footprint environment and be loaded in the Open Footprint environment. So on the one hand, you got your manual data coming in via the calculations. On the other hand, you get your IoT data coming in. And we have to cater for both of them, for both extremes, of course. And the latter is not there today, but let's talk again in 1 to 2 years from now, and the latter will also be there, because we will find ways to quickly collect carbon data for your supply chain, because that is essential to make this a sustainable environment out there. And both we need to take into account. Yeah, we talked already about scope. I already mentioned a little bit about scope three a moment ago. Scope the good support of scope three means I need to be able. When you think about scope three, you need to be able to load the data. I gave an example of IoT over time. That's all by your scope three environment into your own environment. You can also have the other way around. Of course, you could say that whoever runs the scope three will go out there to each of the parties who runs their supply chain on behalf, create that scope three and collect the data in the other way. So there are different ways of starting collecting that data out there. And really that's really we need to further work out. Another element is often people ask, say, hey, what about blockchain? Because we would expect that you need a proof of origin. You have to prove that the value you put in from a carbon footprint is really the real value. Because today, I can put in any value. I can put in 100, I can put in 200, but there's no proof of origin. And people say, oh, you need to have blockchain in here. And of course, I do need to come to a model where I have proof of origin. But as I mentioned, when we start off this whole exercise, if we need to walk before we can run. And today, we're often still crawling. Blockchain to me is running. So do we need over time something like blockchain from a proof of origin point of view? Yes, we do. Do we need today? No. We need to be ready. We have to make sure we can cater for it sometime in the future. Our strategy has to include it, but not today, given the environment we're in today. So we need to be ready for the future to clearly get there. Let's talk about the calculation services. There will be a session tomorrow with from William Fox, who will William and one other person. who will clearly talk about calculation services. And calculation, of course, we are including part of MP2, and it's quite a challenge to really introduce calculation services. Because if you think about it, in our environment, the calculation service could be on the one hand sitting totally inside your open footprint, so the total calculation engine could be part of open footprint. On the other hand, we would say everything sits outside open footprint, and all that open footprint does, in open footprint, you do a call to an external calculation service. The calculation is being done, you get the results back, and put the results back in open footprint. There are two extremes, but both we need to support, and there will be a hybrid number of hybrid versions in between. The calculation engine service will of course go with business rule services, and the business rule services really will pull this whole story together. We are in the beginning of starting to implement these scenarios. You'll hear tomorrow an excellent story from William on where we're coming from, where we're heading for, and how we see this developing, and what the challenges are to introduce these calculation engines inside an open footprint environment, or have it referred to external services, as just explained. Then the other bodies. Let me focus a little bit on WCCD. We've got Anna gave an excellent presentation around what's happening with WCCD, and then people say, well, okay, your open footprint and WCCD are working close together, and we do. Once a month, we sit together for at least an hour, if not longer, and really technical detail how we work together. I see two spaces where we can and will work together. The first one, open footprint will be used by supply chain companies. So if you're part of supply chain, you can store your carbon footprint calculations or your carbon product results immediately into open footprint. Because if you're an open footprint company and you're part of supply chain, then of course you can immediately store your supply chain contributions in your open footprint implementation. And then WCCD could come along with their solution to extract the relevant carbon footprint data via the open footprint API from the platform. So we can ensure that the open footprint from a certain supply chain company is the feeder for WCCD. So that's one interface. That's the one end. So that's one interface. The other interface, I could also be in that same story, I can also be the scope 3 party, where I'm the scope 3 party, where I'm the open footprint, also use open footprint. That means that the total results of WCSD, when you collect all the results of supply chain, the total results can come into via data ingestion services into open footprint of that scope 3 party. And again, I can make sure to make this a seamless experience that our APIs are well aligned. So our thinking, our work we're doing with them is really to make sure that those two ends of the spectrum are well aligned, that our definitions are aligned. And that's really, we are at the beginning of that story, because, okay, we have defined our APIs, we have defined other things. They still have to do it, and we have to make sure that we align those two stories. So we see a clear link over there. And of course, we see lots of other links over there. And we had a question earlier via Heidi asked, oh, should governments join open footprint? Of course they should bodies join, because the more they join, the more we can make sure that these things start fit together. Because in it, it's an ecosystem of companies, of organizations who make this successful and nothing else. I won't go through the roadmap details because we're running a little bit out of time, but I really want, my focus was really, really much to focus at, okay, what are we heading for? So we're heading for an open footprint implementation, either standalone or embedded with other environments. It really has, which is in this, in part of a broad ecosystem providing information to reporting systems and collecting the data on WCSD, feeding WCSD, and there's a whole raft of other systems out there. But in the center, what OpenFootprint does is it defines clear data definitions, data standards, and the access of that data. That's what it does. That we focus at across all industries. Supply chain is not oil and gas. Supply chain is not furniture. Supply chain is every industry we need to cater for. That's why OpenFootprint is across all industries. And you're going to hear tomorrow why that is so important and what we're doing to make that better and easier. Let me stop over here. I have no idea if I have any questions or not, but I'm going to stop, otherwise Heidi gets annoyed with me. Heidi or Sammy, I don't know whether you have questions out there.
You're doing a great job, Johan. You're doing a great job. So do you have a couple more slides? We still have a few more minutes if you want to continue.
I don't want to interrupt, man. I thought we had until 6, until 5 to 6.
Yeah, we've got a couple of questions, Johan, if we can maybe to jump to those, if that would work. Good, excellent. From Bill, we've got will or does OFP already consider carbon offset data?
It will. It's not yet included today in our definitions, but clearly we're going to do that. Yeah, that's also part of our roadmap. There's no, and that's why I said before that whole thinking about the data model and data capabilities are so essential, because these things will come up and clearly we can cater for that. And I don't know whether Gomez is still in the room, but clearly we can cater for that. There's no issue why we can't. But so far, we've not included that in our scope yet. It's not part of MP1 or MP2. It will be clear one of our future. And it's important, those ideas, join the forum or join the OT forum and say, hey, join the O4Print forum, sorry, and really come up with these ideas, suggestions. Yeah, technical, we can do it. It's just a matter of priority.
Cool. Thanks. Yeah, and just to finish out Bill's comments around it, just for the wider group, you know, carbon offset programs and products obviously have various standards and certification information, so that companies are counting for. So I think that's why it was, you know, important from Bill's perspective around carbon neutrality and net zero and those kinds of goals. So good, thank you. And I see one more also from Ian. I know Shamuli, you've answered it, but maybe I'll put the same question over to you as well. You know, how do you see OFP fitting in terms of the methane challenge that people are running into at the moment, in both quantifying it as well as reducing methane?
Yeah, because we're running the challenge, of course. From if I talk from Michelle's point of view, we're running that challenge, of course. The first quantifying. That's the biggest challenge we have today. I mean, quantifying as a site, what is the methane challenge over there? O4Print is really, again, what can do it over there. It, of course, is not a magic bullet over there, but of course, it can keep track of that data, can collect the data. I gave for the examples of the IoT type of environment, because if you think, but first we have to figure out how to collect methane data from large size. I mean, we have certain sites we can do it. Like we if you talk about some of our oil and gas fields, we can do it today, but otherwise we have no good method yet to do it. As long as the moment we can find a good method over there and collect, then there's no reason why we cannot collect that type of data in open footprint. But it is really the keeping track of it is not something which is going to collect. We need other things to make that collection part work.
Good, excellent. All right. So I think we've got just a minute left before we have Luca come on. I don't see any additional questions. I think we're good from a Q&A perspective, Johan.
Thank you. Thank you much.
All right. Terrific. Thank you so much, Johan. That was excellent, truly excellent. And again, just a reminder that all of these sessions are being recorded and will be available within a few weeks. So thank you again.